Hi everyone. So a lot of you will recognize me as well from other months, and so I'm here in another capacity. Someone's saying my volume is very soft. Is that true for everyone, or
you could turn it up a little bit if you've got the capacity.
Okay. I'll also just try to speak a little louder.
Yes, that sounds better.
It does? Okay.
Yep.
Do let me know going forward. So I'm here in another capacity this month. I'm talking to you guys this month about equine end-of-life decision-making, along with my colleague, Lynn Bliven. She, Lynn is an extension colleague of mine at CCE Allegheny. She has, in addition to being a horse person herself, a lot of experience helping people through these decisions, and her area of expertise is composting in particular. So she's here to talk about some of that. And then as a veterinarian, I'll be talking about kind of that side of things. And we're happy to answer any questions we can get to towards the end. So feel free to put those in. All right. So this evening, we'll be covering a few different topics, a variety here. So the first thing I want to get into is how do we assess quality of life in equids? Because of course, that's usually a prerequisite before we make any decisions, right, for euthanasia. Then kind of what do you discuss with your veterinarian? How do you make a plan for euthanasia? And what are some things you might want to bring up? And then I'll get into some of what are the acceptable euthanasia methods for horses. So both the guidelines and then some recommendations as well. And we'll talk a little bit about some more practical considerations like deciding whether to be present or not. Lynn, with her expertise, will be discussing some issues to consider around kind of body disposal. And then I'll come back on and discuss a few things related to kind of considerations for remaining herd members, and then also some information on bereavement and the human-animal bond, because arguably that's what we're all here for, right? So I'll get us started off here with assessing a horse's quality of life. And there are a lot of ways to do this. The definition in general of quality of life varies actually quite a bit in the literature, but one kind of widely accepted definition is that it's the subjective well-being of the individual is their quality of life. And most people are kind of quick to clarify that it's not just an animal's health. It's really the whole patient experience that you want to consider. So usually it's considered quite a holistic assessment of an animal's well-being. So this is including its both negative and positive feelings. So we want to encompass the physical health, of course, which is what we think of usually right away, as well as the psychological state and just kind of more generally the animal's enjoyment of life, which I think this is where we can get hung up a little, right? Because of course, we can't ask them. And so we need to try to think of some tools to figure this out for them, essentially, right? So that's what we're going to talk about. In horses, unfortunately, there's currently not a validated kind of quality of life assessment instrument or tool like there are in some other species. But we need to keep in mind that, of course, health status is a vital component. We need to have as much information about their health as we can to make the decision. But we don't want to forget everything else, right? So that's a big piece, but we want to consider some other things as well. And of course, when we think of equine health and assessing that, we do want to get the veterinarian's perspective usually. But it's the owner that has the most experience with this individual animal. And so usually the owner is very well positioned to have a large degree of input when you're assessing the quality of life. So this isn't something where an outsider like a veterinarian or some other expert can come in and make a judgment alone. Usually it's more of a communication because you're the one that knows the horse the best. And so for that, it's pretty vital that both parties are involved, I would say. That being said, as you can imagine, naturally, we're a little biased as horse owners, right? I know I am. And so the emotions can make it hard. It feels very hard to make a decision when you're very invested emotionally. And it can also be really hard to detect slow changes over time. So if you see your horse every day, maybe you're its caretaker, it might be hard to see this really slow incremental loss of quality of life if you see them all the time, just like with anything else, right? So where do we go from there then? So really the most kind of comprehensive assessment of quality of life should have both the owner or caregiver and the veterinarian, because we kind of each bring something to the table, the kind of expertise in assessing health, and then also knowing the animal quite well. And together, hopefully, you can make a decision that's not only well-informed, but really considering the whole experience of the horse. And you shouldn't actually wait until you're trying to decide whether to euthanize, right? Especially with older geriatric horses, it's great to have routine discussions with your veterinarian on some issues that are common problems with older horses, like pain management, if the horse is in any pain, are we managing it appropriately? A lot of preventive healthcare stuff is especially pertinent in older horses, so weight management, dental care, stuff like that, and then also managing chronic conditions. So plenty of you with older horses will know that they're prone to some chronic conditions like PPID or Cushing's, and just making sure that you're managing all of those appropriately. These can weigh into your kind of assessment of the overall quality of life of the horse, and you don't need to wait. You can, start asking yourself these questions anytime any animal kind of starts developing some chronic conditions or, anything that you're helping, getting the help of your veterinarian to manage. So the basic summary here is that you really want to involve your veterinarian, but don't discount the role that you have, and your knowledge and experience of this individual animal is very helpful in deciding what is this animal's quality of life. Some common questions, we'll get into some assessment tools, but sometimes it's helpful just to kind of get yourself started and try to think of what are some things I should ask myself if I'm trying to make this decision. So some really common ones, and hopefully this all comes to mind quickly. This first one is, does the horse have any pain that can't be managed? If it's not being managed right now, we have to speak with our veterinarian and see if we can change that. And if not, then of course, euthanasia needs to be on the table, right? Some kind of related questions. Is your horse able to do its kind of normal behaviors and activities? So this would, of course, include eating and drinking. Is it able to physically do those things and do them without pain? Your horse had been kind of well managed on maybe some pain medication, maybe it's taking some varicoxib every day or Equiox, and that had been helping and now it's not helping as much. Do we need to look at that again? If they're having difficulty getting up and or moving around, that can be quite distressing for horses. As prey animals, it's really important to them to be able to move around easily. They can feel quite unsafe and have increased stress levels if they have any trouble rising, which unfortunately is a common issue. If you have really bad arthritis and you weigh 1,200 pounds, it can be hard to get up sometimes. And so that's a common concern a lot of owners have, is if my horse is having trouble getting up, is this a welfare issue? And the short answer is yes. So either you need to figure out why it can't get up easily. It might be pain, maybe some weakness. If that's what it is, can we help those and deal with that? If not, then of course, again, you have to have euthanasia on the table. And more generally, these are harder to answer, but is your horse suffering? You could also say, will a change in environment help and or maybe worsen? So let's say winter's coming and you're pretty worried about your horse maybe had a rough winter last time, you couldn't keep a lot of weight on, they had trouble maybe regulating their temperature. Is it possible that maybe that's a little too much to try to put them through again? And also, does your horse have a condition that can't be cured? So maybe your veterinarian has told you there's a diagnosis, there's no treatment, we can try to manage their signs or clinical signs, but we can't ultimately kind of get rid of this disease. That's definitely worth considering, right? Because you don't want your horse to be kind of debilitated or in pain for a long time. So these are some general questions to kind of get yourself started. Sometimes it's very straightforward and you're like, this horse is in too much pain. My vet already said we're doing everything we can to manage the pain and it's not enough. And then that feels more straightforward. A lot of times though, it's in a more of a gray area, right? And so that's where we have trouble and that's why we feel like we need help, right? So there are a few tools you can turn to if you're kind of like, okay, I don't know where to go from here. There are a few options. The British Horse Society has a kind of highly cited tool, I guess, an assessment tool. It's essentially also just a list of questions, but I think it feels a little more objective, even though really it's a subjective evaluation, but I think it feels... Some people, I don't know about you, I make Excel charts to, you know, organize my life and kind of help me make decisions. And so this is for those kind of people who feel like they need a little bit more clear guidance. And you can go, this isn't the entire thing, but this is just a sample piece of it. And so you can see that so it's really just going through these questions. Does your horse not interact with you in the same way as before? So for example, he always used to come greet me in the morning and now he doesn't. And if you say, that is true, and you go down this list and it feels like you're saying yes to every one of them, then you might say, okay, it seems like maybe right now his quality of life isn't great. So either we need to do something about that to treat it, or that maybe we need to consider euthanasia. And so I want to caution though that this, of course, is not, no one's holding you to this. You can just do it on your own if you'd like. You can do it in partnership with your veterinarian. But just because you fill this out doesn't obligate you to any decision. It's meant to just be helpful. So don't be too worried if you fill it out and you feel like, I didn't think I'd say yes as many times. And oh gosh, I thought his quality of life was okay. It might just be a starting point for you to discuss, you know, how to improve your horse's quality of life with your vet. They also have on the British Horse Society website, they have it in another format over there, as well as a few questions, including, and I think these are important, not all questionnaires have something like this, but you'll notice question 3 here is, do you have the time and energy to support an aging or ill horse? And this is a really hard one, right? Because unfortunately, stuff doesn't happen in a vacuum, right? So you do have to consider not just the horse's well-being, but yours as well, and your ability to help the animal, right? And so it's time and energy. You'll see the next question has to do with the financial implications. And so although it doesn't seem fair sometimes, or it makes people quite upset, it's worth thinking about these things too, right? Because you have to be able to, let's say there's a long recovery process for something. If you can't do that, or you don't feel physically or emotionally or financially capable of handling that, that's worth considering too, right? It's not happening in a vacuum. This horse is a part of your life and your life kind of impacts their life as well, right? So it's perfectly normal. And in fact, I would say necessary to think about those things too. One approach that is common in other companion animals. So this is the Ohio State University has a quality of life assessment tool for companion animals, more specifically though, dogs, for example. So we don't necessarily say that my horse wants to play with me, right? So this is more species specific. It's a little different. There's this Likert scale where they say, oh, this indicates a lower or poor quality of life, and this indicates a better quality of life. And of course, this isn't the whole thing. I'm just showing you part of it. But this idea There's a private practice in the US that kind of combined the British Horse Society idea with this, the Ohio State's idea of kind of utilizing this kind of scale. And you can find that online. We'll be sharing a bunch of resources after this talk for those of you who are interested. But it's the same idea. This is a short list of some of the questions, but it has this scale. So you might not, if you don't like this yes, no, it feels too black and white and you want to kind of think about it in a more nuanced way, this might be helpful for you. So you can ask yourself these questions and get a sense, you know, and maybe it's something you could use serially. So you could say, okay, I'm going to do this now. It's summer. He actually, it looks like his quality of life is pretty good. That's kind of how I felt. And then maybe you can do it again in 6 months or a year and kind of see if is anything changing. Do I need to talk to my vet about improving his quality of life? Or are we kind of, you know, progressively getting a bit worse down the road? So I think that can be quite useful for people who might appreciate some more nuance and kind of maybe want to feel a little bit more, they want this data to kind of help them make a decision. I think that can be helpful in those cases. Okay. And then the last thing I wanted to point out when we're thinking about assessing quality of life, especially in horses, and this can be different from some other animals, is that because horses are prey animals, they do tend to mask their pain. That's kind of evolutionarily beneficial, right? So you don't want to declare to all the predators that you're the slow one to pick on, right? So horses are quite adept at this. And if you have a horse who you feel maybe expresses emotions very easily, or, you know, has a little gas colic and is, you know, throwing themselves on the ground, you might not believe me, but I swear evolutionarily as a group, they tend to mask their pain. I think more than we realize, more than I realized, certainly before I became a vet. There was a recent study by Cade Torcivia and Sue McDonald at UPenn. And this is just one figure, but this summarizes their data quite well, I think. They were looking at horses after they had an orthopedic surgery. And they were measuring, they had a video, so they weren't there directly, but there was a live feed on the horse, and they measured discomfort behaviors. So behaviors they've shown in the past are associated with discomfort in the horse, and they would just measure them. So, you know, every few minutes, they would write down how many discomfort behaviors the horse has displayed. And you can see these lines here. So this is an hour right before the blue bar, that's an hour. And so that's a lot of discomfort behaviors because this marker here is at 5. So the hour before a person visited their stall to assess them, like do a physical exam and check on them, they were displaying quite a few discomfort behaviors. During the visit, the horse almost completely stopped those discomfort behaviors altogether. And then as soon as the person left, they resumed those discomfort behaviors again. And sometimes the person wasn't actually even entering the stall. They were just checking on them visually from the outside. And this is just one example, one mare, but they found that when they looked at all of the data together, the horses, this pattern tends to be true across all of the horses. So if you think, oh no, I check on him every day and he looks fine, maybe have this in the back of your mind and you know, take other pieces of information as well to try to decide, is my horse uncomfortable or in pain or not? Because they're very good at hiding it, unfortunately. There are some tools we can use to get around this a little bit if you don't, let's say, have a video camera that you can use. There's something called a horse grimace scale. This exists in other species too. This is just a little pull out. There are a lot of different figures in this paper and others if you're curious. And essentially, they've found that horses in pain have a predictable set of changes they make on their face that are pretty subtle. Of course, they don't want, you know, the predator from 100 yards away to notice this, but they're reliably indicating that the horse is in pain. So for example, the position of the ears, the tightening of the muscles around their orbit or kind of around the bony part of their eye. And this is just two of many changes they've found. And the horse grimace scale isn't the only one. There are a lot of others that I'm listing here in case you're interested. if you're either worried about your horse specifically or just want to kind of become more adept at recognizing these subtle signs in horses, it's something you could look at some of this literature on, and you can also talk to your veterinarian about it if you want to get a hand on in kind of interpreting some of these signs. So that's worthwhile, I think, if you're interested. Okay. And then I just wanted to mention, I'll get into this a little bit more later, but I think probably the hardest part about making a decision with regards to euthanasia when you're assessing quality of life is that some people feel very overwhelming guilt even thinking about it, even though they know it's for the horse's best interests. They can't prevent this feeling of guilt they have. And so it's vital, and there have been studies to show this, that you get support in this, and that can be in a lot of forms that I'll talk about later. But the vital pieces of this are this shared decision making. Then you don't feel so alone in this decision, and your veterinarian can be a good partner for this. And also feeling like you're making an informed decision often will also help reduce these feelings of guilt and uncertainty. If you already have a good relationship with your veterinarian, that can help quite a bit, and it's someone you can lean on during these times because they've seen this and they can answer your questions. And all the ones I know are very empathetic and would be happy to talk to you about this. So I think that's something worth thinking about. Okay, so let's say you've assessed quality of life and/or for some other reason you've decided an animal does need to be euthanized. So then you can make a plan. And I would recommend that before the euthanasia itself, you make some arrangements, basically. So of course, you make the decision to euthanize. And this, like I said, this is usually an agreement with your veterinarian. And then before that, you'll also want to, and of course, I'm talking about non-emergency euthanasia, right, where you don't have as much time to plan or prepare. So I'm talking about if you have a little time to prepare, you can sometimes consider the timing. So this is in multiple ways, but for example, the season, if you live in an area where the ground freezes during the winter, that can be make digging. If your plan is burial, that can make that quite challenging. Whatever disposal option you are electing, and Lynn will talk more about that shortly, you want to make sure that whatever it is will be available in a timely manner. So you can't, you want to have that set up kind of before you schedule the euthanasia and make sure that that'll, be taken care of. And so you don't have to focus on that later, essentially. And then of course, if you're a boarder, if you're boarding your horse somewhere, you do want to communicate with the property owner, let them know what you're thinking, and also kind of talk to them about a plan, especially probably with regards to disposal. And then some people have their horses are insured, and depending on the situation, you might want to check the details of coverage. If you are making a claim, some plans require that you notify them. Of course, this varies a lot in terms of why is the horse being euthanized, but sometimes that's relevant and it's worth keeping on a list kind of things to think of. Another thing I think it's good to try to decide beforehand is whether you want to be present at the euthanasia or not. Either way is fine. And I think some of the information I'll talk about shortly here may help you decide, hopefully. Whatever you decide, it is best to communicate with your vet, just because they'll need to kind of recruit someone or maybe bring a technician with them if there won't be someone else there to help. And there may be others that maybe have a close relationship with the horse or have expressed interest in being at the euthanasia. And so you can communicate with anyone you think that might apply to as well. And then lastly, I think it's worth thinking about, how do you think you'll need some time off after work? If so, it can be nice to request that in advance. Again, this is if you're planning ahead and not in an emergency situation. But I would argue that even if you think you don't need it, at least maybe take a day if you can, just to reflect, I think, even if you think you'll be okay, you never know how it'll kind of hit you. And so I think it's nice to plan, if you can, to maybe take some time off afterwards. Okay, so next up, I want to touch on a few of the methods of euthanasia. I know that some people find it a little bit easier to have in their mind what will be happening so that they don't have as much anxiety, you know, kind of coming up to the event. And so I want to touch on some of the approved euthanasia methods for horses. The only acceptable methods are the AVMA approved ones. And so the AVMA is the American Veterinary Medical Association. And they put out guidelines for the euthanasia of animals about every 10 years, I believe, and they just published some in 2020. So those are up to date, and I'll go over some of those. I think it's worth defining euthanasia. I've said it a lot and haven't actually defined it yet. It's actually from the Greek eu meaning good and thanatos meaning death. And so it translates to a good death. And I like, there's a quote from the AVMA guidelines that I like. They say, a good death is tantamount to the humane termination of an animal's life. And I agree with that. And I think, I don't know a single veterinarian who doesn't both take euthanasia very seriously and also think that it's, think it's incredibly important that every animal has a good death. And it's generally very important to us, and we take it very seriously. And so you can be assured that if a veterinarian is involved, we care a lot, and it's important to us that the animal has a good death. So in horses, the most common by far, at least historically, has been an overdose of barbiturates. Usually it's pentobarbital that can be alone or sometimes in combination with other things. If there are multiple brands, but you might recognize maybe a bottle like this if you've seen a euthanasia before. Usually this is given intravenously, so in the jugular, which is in the horse's neck, sometimes in a catheter. And depending on the situation, on the individual horse, on your veterinarian, they might give sedatives either before or after the catheter is in place, and you can communicate with them and check what the plan will be, just so you're all on the same page. And I thought it might be helpful for those of you who haven't seen IV catheterization in horses to see a couple images of that. It's just the catheter in the horse's neck, so that if it is the first time you're seeing it at a euthanasia, hopefully it's not alarming at all. This first image, this is actually just a little syringe, and they're injecting a tiny bit of fluid under the skin. It's actually usually something along the lines of lidocaine. So it's a little bit of numbing. And it's going right over the vein in the skin, right over the vein. The idea here is that you're numbing this area so that ultimately when you do put the catheter in, they're not feeling that. And so the catheter is a bit larger. So you kind of block the area first. And then when you put the catheter in, it's not painful at all. So usually that'll happen. And then once that sets in, they'll place the catheter. It kind of looks like this. You're again kind of holding off the vein, and it's right kind of on the side of the neck there. And then again, depending on the situation and the vet, they may or may not sew it in. And again, because we have that lidocaine blood there, the horse won't feel this either. So none of this should bother the horse per se, especially if they have a little bit of sedation on board in advance. Usually this is not a stressful part of the procedure for the horse. Some vets you may see use a butterfly catheter. So I just thought I'd show a picture. Instead of placing a whole catheter, sometimes they'll kind of just hold in a needle, and they kind of have this little handle. It's called a butterfly for that reason. And sometimes you'll see that instead. So both of these are pretty common options if you're using an overdose of barbiturates. Another accepted method of euthanasia in horses is either penetrating captive bolt or gunshot. The benefit of these approaches is that, of course, you don't have the drug, you don't have to deal with the drugs or any residue, you know, exposure to wildlife or scavengers. It's also instantaneous, which is good. A drawback, especially with gunshot anyways, is the safety issue, right? You for sure need someone to be very highly trained and very sure of what they're doing, right? So definitely pros and cons. This first image is of a captive bolt. It's called a penetrating captive bolt. The idea is essentially, it's very similar to a gunshot, but instead of a bullet leaving a gun, you just have a metal rod that doesn't, it protrudes out, it penetrates the skull, but it doesn't leave the tool. So it's not, for that reason, it's considered a bit safer because there's not a bullet. So you, in theory, would have a much harder time injuring someone if there were any accidents or something. And then this next image is of either for use with a captive bolt or gunshot, where you're going to aim, and it's a cartoon. So the unfortunately, the target is rather small in comparison to the size of their whole skull, so you do have to be very careful. And for this reason, you really only can resort to this method if you're trained. So you have to draw a line between the outside of the eyelids, so right on the outside corner there, up to the base of the opposite ear. And it's actually useful to truly draw this line on the animal, maybe with livestock crayon or something like that, grease paint, so that you're very, very sure exactly where you'll be aiming, so that later in the moment, you're not questioning yourself. So it's a small target. You absolutely do have to hit it. Otherwise, there are pretty serious welfare consequences. So again, I just want to emphasize that these methods really only should be performed by trained personnel, but especially in cases where you can't use barbiturates for some reason, it can be a good and acceptable alternative for sure. If for some reason those aren't available, there could be a lot of potential reasons why those might not be an option in any given case. There are some what they call adjunctive measures. So for example, some rendering plants, and Lynn will talk about this shortly, and landfills will refuse any livestock that's been euthanized with barbiturates. For safety, you don't want it to get into the food supply. You also don't want scavenging wildlife to get poisoned by any barbiturates. So sometimes you can use some of these alternative methods if maybe there's not a captive bolt or a gun available, or someone's not comfortable with those methods. And I just want to clarify that the first step in all of these methods is essentially anesthetizing them. So you put the horse into a deep surgical plane of anesthesia, maybe with xylazine or ketamine. If you've ever been present at maybe like a castration of a horse in a field, it's the exact same initial procedure. So you'll lie them down with the drugs, you try to get them to fall as gently as possible, and then they're unconscious, they're anesthetized. So they're in lateral recumbency, they're completely unconscious, they can't feel anything. Then once you're sure they're in a deep surgical plane of anesthesia, then you can perform these adjunctive methods. So for example, potassium chloride, magnesium sulfate, and then there's also a method. Of course, this requires quite a bit of training, but you can introduce lidocaine actually to an area around the spinal cord near the brain. And so this is quite useful because, as you can imagine, lidocaine is sometimes easier to get your hands on than some of these other things. And so this can be a good method. If you're there, what the vet will be doing once they're anesthetized is kind of aiming in this area. And then instilling the lidocaine into a particular area around their spinal cord. So these are all definitely alternatives in those cases where the other options aren't available. All right. And I just want to clarify a couple of things. If you haven't been present at a euthanasia before, or I would argue even if you have, but not for an equine euthanasia, they are kind of different. And so I think I just want to clarify some things that are a bit different. I think the most important thing to remember is this order. So the horse is anesthetized first and it loses consciousness. Because of that, their muscle tone is lost, and that's what causes them to fall. So if they're falling, they are unconscious. So you don't have to worry that they're being stressed out by this. They're only going to be falling if they're unconscious. So that's good, right? And then after that, once they've fallen down, their heart rate, their heartbeat and their breathing can actually continue kind of automatically. They're not conscious anymore, but that can keep going for a little while. And so don't worry if your vet is listening or something, that this means that the horse, it hasn't lost consciousness. If they've fallen, then they've lost consciousness. And so you don't have to worry that they're suffering at this point. This hopefully is quite obvious, but horses are large. And the reason I'm pointing this out is that when they do lose muscle tone, they of course have to fall, right? Their legs give out. And that can be upsetting to some people. And I think it's perfectly okay to say, you know what, I'm not okay being there for that part. And that's fine. Just communicate that in advance with your veterinarian. And you can always say goodbye afterwards too. So it's completely up to you. Just keep that in mind. And another thing, especially maybe if you've been present at euthanasia of any animal, really, you've probably heard or seen that sometimes there can be some muscular activity afterwards, something that can alarm people. It's not super common, but sometimes there will be what's called agonal gasping. It seems like they're trying to take a deep breath, but again, they're completely unconscious. So if you see any of this, you don't have to worry at all that they're suffering. It doesn't imply pain or distress. The animal is unconscious and you don't have to worry at all about them. I'm only mentioning it because it can be distressing to some people. And I think it helps to remember they're completely unconscious, so they're not suffering. And just lastly, you do want to be really careful because they'll be falling. It's hard to sometimes completely control the directionality of that and the exact timing. And so you just want to be very alert in terms of listening to your veterinarian. If they tell you to move or to stand somewhere, just take their advice in the moment, and then you can think about it later. But that's, they have your safety always in mind. And so just make sure you're listening to them. And again, remember that your horse is unconscious once they're falling. So the next thing you'll see is that usually your vet, it'll depend a little bit on the situation, but often what they'll do is they'll confirm death, often by listening to their heart rate. They might do a couple other things, check some other reflexes, and then they'll let you know usually once they've confirmed. And don't be alarmed if it seems like your vet is really listening to the heart for a while, because remember the animal is gone, they're unconscious, they don't have any more brain activity. It's just that sometimes the heart sounds keep going for a while, well after the brain activity has ceased. And so they're just listening to kind of wait until the heart slowly stops. But remember, you don't have to be alarmed at all. And it doesn't mean that the horse is awake or aware of anything. And then it's perfectly fine to ask your vet, hey, do you mind if I spend some time with my horse after they've passed, once they've confirmed? You're welcome to take all the time you want. And I would really encourage that you have someone nearby for emotional support, if possible. That's, I think, universally been helpful in all the cases I've seen. And like we said, I think it's usually best if you can kind of make all the other arrangements beforehand so that in the moment you're not worrying about this, including disposal. So I think Lynn will step in now to talk about that.
Great. Thank you, Lindsay. So yeah, we're certainly, you know, that's one of the realities. We're going to have to just figure out what are we going to dispose of the carcass. Again, these are large animals. If you have acreage of your own, it might be, you might have the option of doing something with on site, or perhaps based on your location or your personal preferences, you prefer off site. So we'll talk a little bit about what those considerations are. Lindsay had already mentioned, you know, the concerns of disposal of animals, you know, for safety reasons. So in 2003, the Food and Drug Administration added an environmental warning for animal euthanized products. Basically that an euthanized animal must be properly disposed of, which can be either through deep burial, incineration, or other methods that in compliance with the state and local laws. And again, this is to prevent the consumption of the carcass by scavenging wildlife. So it's not legal to just put your animal out in the back corner. Not that most of us would consider doing that with our pet animals or our horses or livestock. But properly built and managed compost piles are certainly another method that could be considered. And some of the agencies that might be involved in the, again, for here in New York State, we'll talk a little bit more about the involvement of the Department of Environmental Conservation, but there are also town and county governments. New York State is a local law, so there may be some variance based on where you're located within the state, and also the Department of Ag and Markets. So, you know, the other thing we need to consider, certainly when, as you know, Lindsay said, when you have ability to plan in advance, but there may also be, you know, what if there's an emergency situation? What if there's a disaster or a disease outbreak? So thinking ahead of time, making some decisions and having some guidance to direct, you know, which agencies you might need to interact with in order to be sure that you are complying with the measures. Lindsay, I think you'll have to advance the slides for me. Great, thank you. So we want to talk about some of the specific options that are available to you. So again, disease animal disposal law in New York State, a carcass of large domestic animals, and this is going to include but not limited to horses, cows, sheep, swine, goats, and mules, which have died or otherwise than slaughter, shall be buried at least 3 feet deep. So burial needs to be at least 3 foot of cover below the surface of the ground or otherwise disposed of in a sanitary manner by the owner of such animal, whether the carcasses are located on the premise of such owner or elsewhere. Such disposal shall be completed within 72 hours after the owner is directed to do so by a peace officer. Hopefully you've made these plans in advance so you don't have that. But again, we want to make these, make sure that we are doing this in a quick manner for reasons of sanitation. And obviously, you know, just something that is a good practice. So DEC, the Department of Environmental Conservation, is the one that oversees or regulates permits. So with for animal carcasses, if you're going to dispose of them on your own property, there's not a permit required, if assuming that you're not a CAFO farm. So CAFO would be a confined animal feeding operation. So on your own farm with acreage, you can compost up to 10 or less animals a year, even from offsite. So if you yourself don't have the space and you would like to consider composting or burial, it can be done at another farm if you make those arrangements in advance. When it comes to cremation, you know, there are very few facilities that will take large animals. So and also can be cost prohibitive. So Cornell University has a crematory. In doing some research, the only other one I found was downstate. And so there are actually a couple in Massachusetts or Pennsylvania. So you would need to look into that, but most of the crematory cremation options would be for small pets. And so you may have, that may not be something that would be available to you. Also carcass disposal businesses there. So like your waste management facility or your landfill may take carcasses. You would generally need to contact your, either if you have a countywide landfill, you need to contact them. If you work with someone like waste management or another disposal facility, they may, they do allow landfilling, but it may be only at certain sites. And so you would need to think about, do I have the ability to transport the carcass and how would I get it there in a reasonable amount of time? And then the last one there is on rendering, and rendering is pretty limited. As Lindsay already mentioned, the concern for drug residues. So some of you, probably most people with horses, also have dogs and may have heard of the dogs that were killed in 2018 when phenobarbital residue got into dog food through rendering. And so there are very few renderers who will take horse carcasses. Not to say that we don't see that now with other pets. So again, that note on that euthanasia is we really need to make sure that we are being careful if you are chemically euthanizing your horse, that you are doing it in a manner that is not going to predispose your domestic animals and or wildlife to get into that residue. You can go to the next slide. So then why compost mortality? So there are a couple of things here that, you know, again, it can be, it is certainly an environmentally acceptable when done correctly. So there are some things that you need to do in order to make sure that you are prepared for it. So you noted in the last slide, the bed that was prepared there, you can see here, there's a good base of large chip material underneath. Perhaps you have chopped straw. There are ways that you can make this bed in order to protect the flow of any fluids that might get into the groundwater. So those are things we want to make sure, but it is an environmentally acceptable way and it can be economical. And as Lindsay pointed out, we do have to think about that as well. So, you know, we've cared for and we've nurtured this animal, but we also need to think about, you know, what can we do within the context of our ability. It also is a biosecure way. So again, those carcasses are not leaving the farm. We're going to manage that. So composting, decomposition is something that occurs naturally. Composting is just what we are doing to manage that, to make sure that it's done in a safe way. The other thing about it is that composting is something that we can do year round. So we do, again, have to plan. We need a basis to put that on. But as Lindsay pointed out, if it's frozen, it's pretty hard to dig the ground and get down 3 foot deep to bury a carcass. But if we have the materials, we can certainly compost year round. So again, it can be low cost, done with equipment that you have right on your farm. So some of the key things to consider would be location, and the location would be the same whether or not you're talking about burial or composting. We want to make sure we're protecting groundwater. So groundwater and surface water. So we have the depiction here, 200 feet, a minimum of 200 feet away from a stream, a well, or a pond area is what we need for that location. And there's some things that we're going to do for key things to monitor. So again, the picture at the top there kind of shows we're starting with that base of about 2 foot of dense materials. So things like wood chips, if you're, you know, you live in an area where they're, you know, they're doing some storm tree maintenance or and you can get chips, have that available, put it someplace on your farm if you need to have that. So that's something to consider when you're doing that. Basically, I will share a resource with you that talks about troubleshooting and monitoring. We want to monitor to make sure that the carcass is covered. We're going to actually pierce the gut to prevent bloating. That just helps to keep the prevent it from becoming unburied. Monitoring that to make sure that it's maintaining cover. And then there's a whole list of resources as far as troubleshooting. So composting, if done correctly, again, is a biosecure way. It's sanitary. It shouldn't smell if you're doing things in correctly, and we'll help you with navigating some of that. So then next, you know, one of the other things to consider is, you know, certainly we wouldn't recommend, you know, using the compost perhaps on a garden, but you might compost locally, the location, and, you know, use it in this picture here. They're depicting their, you know, they're planting a tree. The composting in a static pile, which was what we're showing in the last slide, generally in about 12 months, the majority of the carcass will be completely broken down, with the exception of the very large bones, so the femur, the hip, the skull. So those items you can put back into another compost pile. You can turn it or rotate it, but the other material would be suited to use for compost, whether you want to plant a tree or you want to fertilize your pasture or whatever you would like to do with that. So the next slide there. So I will say that there is some very good resources through the Cornell Waste Management, and someone had asked earlier about access to the slides, so you will see the slides, and it will have these hyperlinks available to you. There is a fact sheet that goes into complete detail on how to build the pile. I didn't get into that today because of the time frame, but I am certainly more than willing to assist anybody with questions. But I will say that this publication walks you quite through it quite completely. And there also is a video that shows, again, some of the steps involved in building the compost pile and how this can be a viable way for you to manage disposal of your animal, particularly if you would like to do that on your farm and not have to worry about moving the carcass off of the premises. So then I think there was one question about how long does the carcass from chemically euthanized animals, putting animals at risk. So again, within that year time frame, the drugs will dissipate. You still want to make sure that you are monitoring that pile, that you have put that good at least 2 foot of cover. So the 2 foot base and the 2 foot of cover in order to make sure that you don't have any domestic or wild animals that are getting into that pile. And then the other thing would be in designing that pile is making sure that you are managing the water around it. So you might need to add additional bedded matter so that you don't have any ponding or pooling. That will be an area where then it would cause some odor issues similar to, you know, manure storage. So we'd want to make sure that you're managing that pile for water runoff. So I think that answers the question. Thank you. I'll turn it over to Lindsay again.
Thank you, Lynn. And just a few last items we wanted to touch on. So once you've made the decision and the animal has been euthanized, it can be important sometimes or relevant to consider the rest of your herd. So I want to touch on grief in animals, kind of what to do with the rest of your herd, kind of the requirement for companionship, and then also briefly special cases with, for example, orphaned foals. So this is a very common question, whether there's evidence of grief in animals. Unfortunately, there's very little scientific study of this, but anecdotally, many people have observed that whether it's grief or not, often remaining animals exhibit some type of behavioral change. There was an interesting study in 2016 where they interviewed a large group of veterinarians and ask them, what do you think might explain these behavioral changes in the remaining animals? And they gave a pretty wide variety of potential options or kind of explanations for this. It's from kind of very, I guess you could say utilitarian, like chemical changes in the dying body, maybe awareness somehow that the animal is ill and or depending on the situation, deceased. They might be sensing some kind of change in the physical and or emotional state in the animal, if it's ill especially. I think it's interesting to consider that a lot of vets propose that the animals were actually reacting to the change in emotions of the people. And so, as we all know, animals are very perceptive to our emotions, and that could really be impacting any remaining animals, of course, right? Some people believe that they're probably exhibiting grief similar to humans, and others very simply kind of think of this as just animals displaying empathy. And so, again, like I said, it's a very difficult subject to study, and there hasn't been much scientific study of it, but these are some common proposed kind of explanations for the behavior changes we see. And I'd say that the maybe most common question after this is, should I let my remaining horses spend time with the body? So once an animal is euthanized, is it important that I let my horses gather around it or lead them up to it? The short answer is we don't know. I would say it depends a little bit on your individual situation, the setup, where the euthanasia was performed. I know some veterinarians recommend this if possible. I would say the only caveat, the reason to maybe consider not doing it in some cases, is that sometimes the animals seem to have no reaction, which is fine, of course, right? Sometimes they do, though, and they might exhibit strange behaviors that might be upsetting to the owner or the person handling the horse. So We don't have a lot of evidence one way or another, but it is a common practice. And as long as you're kind of prepared for anything, any behaviors they might exhibit, I'd say there's not much to lose. If it's safe and feasible, then you're welcome to do this, although I wouldn't say it's required. And then, of course, we all know that horses are social or herd animals, and you should keep in mind that, you know, we're assessing the quality of life of this animal before we euthanize it. We need to also think about the quality of life of the remaining herd, right? So if you just have a pair of horses and one is euthanized, you have a solo horse now, right? And so we have to consider their quality of life. Companionship is very important for quality of life, especially in animals that live naturally in these small social groups like horses. There's been some study in this kind of area. There are alternatives. What can you do? I wanted to say there's a caveat that in general, most research supports the idea that other species probably aren't suitable alternatives. There was a somewhat recent study last year, actually, that goats probably don't provide enough suitable companionship for horses. There's not that same social support aspect as there would be with another horse. But if you're able to take another horse on, a lot of rescues are looking for sometimes just foster, sometimes permanent homes for companion horses that may not be rideable. If that's not an option, a lot of people consider kind of group equine retirement facilities so that you don't have to bring another horse on, but your remaining horse can still live with companions, which is quite important. And then I just wanted to quickly touch on the idea of if it's a dam that has died either, you know, during or shortly after birth, or maybe the mare hasn't died, but she's just rejected the foal, then a nurse mare is always the ideal. And so there are often networks of people who can organize matchups between either dams who've lost their foal and or potential nurse mares that can be induced to lactate for orphaned foals. So that's always the ideal if you can. In this situation, always reach out to your network because usually people move mountains to try to get a nurse mare to an orphan foal. Always worth asking. And then lastly, I just wanted to touch on, if you're here, you probably find the kind of human-animal bond with horses very important. And I wanted to touch on, it's very common to have feelings of responsibility and kind of moral obligation towards your horse. You feel often responsibility as a horse owner or this duty of care to make this decision. But then of course that can weigh quite heavily on us, right? It's a very difficult decision and usually you have a strong bond with this animal. And I thought this was interesting. There was a recent study and it was a social science study and they said that responsibility grief is actually quite unique to pet death. And so it's worth considering that this, you don't have to feel strange if you're like, I can't believe I'm this upset about this. It's very common to feel pretty upset about this. And because of that, it's very helpful and has been shown to be very helpful to have a shared decision-making approach. Like I said, that can be your veterinarian as a partner or more social support kind of. So people that either you're close to or that would understand your situation in kind of another support group type setting. And one option, if maybe you're not really sure where to start or who to turn to, is pet loss support hotlines. Cornell has one. This is the information. There are others as well though, and these are usually staffed by veterinary students or veterinarian volunteers. Here's a list of a few others in some other states. And then I'll say, that's a good starting place. But if you find that you feel either really overwhelmed with grief or you're not kind of getting enough support or you feel like you need something more, definitely reach out to a therapist for additional support if needed. This is a very difficult decision and it's perfectly very common and reasonable to reach out for additional support. And you shouldn't have to go through this alone. So I will, here are some of the references we referred to, and then like we've typed in the Q&A, we're also going to share some resources. So once this recording is ready, we'll email all the registrants with some resources, these references, and then also a link to the recording. So I'm sorry we went right up to just after seven there, but we're happy to answer any questions that are remaining. Anything we haven't touched on?
I was just going to say, Lindsay, there were a few early on that were in regards to pain, and I'm not sure if all of those got answered. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I was trying to answer some of the compost ones. Maybe Calvin or Cal did catch up on that.
Calum or Vanessa can maybe let us know if there are any themes that we haven't touched on.
Okay, maybe Callum did answer those questions. So.
Yeah.
Callum answered quite a few questions.
So there was a question about, is the gunshot area of the skull different in bovines? So you're going to, do you want to address that? You're going to kind of make a line. It's going to look a little differently, but.
Yeah, and the AVMA guidelines for euthanasia have that same exact figure for a bunch of livestock, well, a bunch of every species. But if you want that exact image for cattle, you can just Google the AVMA guidelines for euthanasia. We might be able to send them out also. And they have exactly where to aim in each of the, for every species, really. Yeah. So that's.
It's going to be a similar method. And again, drawing that actual line on the animal, it is important because you want to be very accurate. So that the, you know, it is one hit and goes down.
That's vital.
And, you know, back to disposal methods, these disposal methods are certainly viable for other livestock. So we know that, you know, maybe you have a pet goat with your horse and you might need to think about disposal considerations there.
And I see a question that touches on a subject I also get asked a lot is, if my horse doesn't seem to be lying down, is this concerning? What does this indicate? This is a fairly common problem, especially in older horses. So if they get really bad arthritis or they're in pain for some other reason, they can be very reluctant to lie down because it's so difficult to get back up because of the pain they have and or some weakness sometimes. So because of that, they'll often avoid lying down for as long as they can and then collapse. Historically, that had been kind of diagnosed as narcolepsy in a lot of cases. We now know that true narcolepsy in horses is actually really rare. What it usually is that it's sleep deprivation. So if a horse has been really reluctant to lie down for a long time, they'll get quite tired. They can do a certain type of sleep, slow wave sleep, standing up. But for REM, the rapid eye movement sleep, just like we do when we're dreaming, they need to lie down to get that, and they have to have their muscles are completely, they have to be lying down. And so they'll become sleep deprived if they aren't able to or are reluctant to lie down, and then they'll collapse. And so formerly we thought of that as narcolepsy. Now we know that's almost always sleep deprivation. So yes, if your horse is experiencing difficulty lying down and or that you don't really see them lying down, it's worth chatting with your vet, seeing if maybe they're in pain, undiagnosed, and or you could manage their pain a little bit better. What else? Any other themes we need to touch on? Someone asked, when a mare loses her foal, sometimes you can partner up an orphan foal with a mare who's lost her foal. If you're asking, should you show the mare the foal after it's passed, that's, I would say, the same answer I gave for remaining herd mates. There's not a lot of science on that. It is a common practice, but it's okay if you can't do it. We're not sure what their concept of death is, but it usually doesn't hurt. So if you think that would help you emotionally and or maybe would help the mare, you're welcome to do that. And I'm not aware of any contraindications for that.
There was a question in regards to burying on your own property. Is it common to perform the euthanasia at the burial site? I think that would be, you know, is it easily accessible? And that's something that, you know, as long as your veterinarian is willing to do so, that may be much more humane and easier on yourself. As long as, you know, again, with burial, you have to be far enough away that obviously someone's not going to be in danger of falling in the hole if you've already prepared that, but certainly is a viable thing to consider. And it's much, it makes it a little easier on you. I've had to put horses down before, and yes, if I can take them to the site, it is a little bit easier.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then someone's also asking, of all the methods, which is least painful? So I just want to address the AVMA approved methods should not cause any pain. And so if you're using an approved method, which you should do, then the horse will not experience pain. So maybe they're being euthanized because of a painful condition, but the euthanasia itself should be painless. The only tiny exception I can think of is the blocking. You know, if you've ever gotten a little lidocaine, maybe you'll feel a tiny pinch, but that would be even less pain than a vaccination. So don't worry that this is painful at all, and you wouldn't have to make a decision based on what's causing the least pain, because none of them should cause pain. So you don't have to worry about that.
So Lindsay, there is another question here. And where is the best place on the farm or boarding facility to put the horse down? Meaning in the presence of other horses, like the paddock mates or more isolated area. I'm just wondering if it was upsetting to pasture mates.
Yeah, that's a pretty similar answer as I would give to, do we need to give them access to the body to grieve? It's not very well understood. I would say one exception might be, it can sometimes cause horses to be alarmed, either seeing another horse fall and or kind of approaching the body afterwards. That's certainly not universal, but if you're worried that might be the case, you don't want alarm to then kind of spread throughout a herd and they're galloping, right? So you'll know your herd best. I would say if you don't have a choice, you don't have a choice, right? So you can do what you can to kind of shield. Usually it's nice to have it in a more protected area. But I would say another consideration is that if your horse, the horse that you're euthanizing, has separation anxiety from other horses, it might be nice to not isolate them. And so they might get a little or quite stressed if they're taken away from a group to be euthanized. And so in that case, maybe you can try to maintain some visual contact, as long as you're fairly confident that the other horses won't get really upset by that. It's hard to know though, right? So it's a little hard to predict. You just do the best you can. And I've never seen this go really wrong either way. So I think you just do the best you can. All right, we've gone well past now. I wasn't way, sorry about that. If you had a question that we weren't able to touch on, feel free to reach out to us. And we're gonna send out that email, Vanessa, I wanna say usually early next week with the recording and then some of the additional resources. And thanks for joining us, and good luck with your decisions.
Thanks, everyone.